Our next talk, Chance Noffsinger from the Department of Ecology and Evolutionary Biology at the University of Tennessee. Atmospheric deposition lowers fungal diversity in an endangered spruce-fir ecosystem.
All right. So yes, today I'm going to be talking about how atmospheric deposition lowers fungal diversity in an endangered spruce-fir ecosystem. My name is Chance Noffsinger, and this research was performed under the supervision of Dr. Brandon Matheny at the University of Tennessee. I'd like to start off by acknowledging all my funding sources, which include the Carlos C. Campbell Fellowship, the Appalachian Highlands Science Learning Center, the Hessler Research Award, the EEB Graduate Research Award, and the Friends of the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. I would also like to thank all my lab members and all the other important contributors that have made this research possible, some of which are pictured here in the bottom. So first, Fraser fir is declining due to climate change, the balsam woolly adelgid, and atmospheric deposition. Mature stands have experienced up to 90% mortality in some regions of the Great Smoky Mountains. Red spruce commonly co-occurs with Fraser fir, but it can be found at lower elevations and has a larger geographic distribution. These spruce fir forests are usually found around 1,500 to 2,000 meters in elevation, and I have a nice picture I took here from the park this last summer. Fraser or spruce fir forests have a disjunct distribution, which extends from southern Virginia through the Great Smoky Mountains and has even been reported in some areas of northern Georgia. The largest contiguous area of spruce fir is found in the Great Smoky Mountains, and it's pictured here in red on the right. This plant community hosts mycorrhizal fungi, which I'll talk a little bit more about in a moment. Spruce fir forests are important because they improve watershed quality and provide a habitat for some endemic species. Atmospheric deposition is the movement of rain, particles, and gases from the atmosphere to Earth's surface. The two primary pollutants are sulfur dioxide and nitrogen oxides, which come from the burning of fossil fuels, electrical power generators, vehicles, and manufacturing. When these molecules interact with water and other chemicals in the air, this produces acid rain, which significantly lowers the pH of soil. Atmospheric deposition is also an important source of particle-bound trace metals like lead. So nitrogen deposition has more than doubled annually due to anthropogenic activities, and research has shown that this is negatively impacting the growth, composition, and function of microorganisms in the soil. In 2006, Weathers and colleagues did a survey of nitrogen deposition in the park, and they used lead as a proxy for understanding the rate of deposition. So they would measure lead content in soil cores, and then they correlated this lead content with nitrogen deposition parks or nitrogen deposition sites at lower elevations in the park. And when they did this, they found a 17-fold change in the scaling factor or that amount of lead content throughout the Great Smoky Mountains. They discovered that spruce fir forests were receiving the highest amounts of deposition. And this is because deposition was increasing with elevation. They also found that deposition was the highest on north-facing slopes. And you can see here Weather's study pictured on the right, the park boundary is outlined in black, and each circle represents a soil core, and then the size of that circle indicates the amount of lead content, which again is being used as a proxy for the amount of deposition occurring at that plot. So I'm interested in how nitrogen deposition affects fungal communities in the soil. And there are two primary groups present in this ecosystem. We have the beneficial mutualists, which I'll refer to as biotrophs throughout the rest of this presentation. And these contain the mycorrhizal fungi, two of which are pictured here on the right. Mycorrhizal fungi are important because they improve nutrient uptake to plants, and in return, the plants provide carbon through photosynthetically derived sugars. The other major group are the decomposers fungi, which I'll refer to as saprotrophs. These are responsible for the breakdown of dead plant and animal material and the return of these nutrients back to the ecosystem. Fungi have responded in various ways to increased levels of nitrogen. Nitrogen deposition has been shown to decrease the abundance and richness of mycorrhizal mushrooms, but this varies based on functional differences between species. Mycorrhizal communities have also been shown to shift in fine scale changes to total nitrogen and pH. Saprotrophic fungi have also been shown to decrease with increased levels of nitrogen, and carbon was determined to be an important factor controlling this fungal community. So the goal of my study is to understand how nitrogen deposition and other soil factors vary across the spruce fir ecosystem and how this will affect overall fungal community diversity. I aim to characterize the fungal community present within the spruce fir ecosystem of the Great Smoky Mountains National Park to determine which soil factors have the largest impact on fungal diversity and to understand how nitrogen deposition and soil conditions are linked to changes in community composition for those two major fungal groups, which are again those biotrophs and saprotrophs. I first predict that both fungal guilds, the biotrophs and saprotrophs, will decrease in diversity at plots with the highest levels of nitrogen deposition. And based on preliminary analysis, I believe that this decrease will occur at lead contents that are greater than 40 milligrams per kilogram. I also predict that fungal soil communities will become more homogeneous at high levels of nitrogen deposition. Finally, I predict that nitrophilic taxa, or those taxa or genera that prefer high levels of nitrogen, like Rushla and Scleroderma, will increase in plots with the highest levels of nitrogen deposition. So for my methods, this past summer, I collected 45 randomly selected soil plots from the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. Again, here you can see the border of the park outlined in black, and each of these blue tags represents a soil plot that I collected. For reference, here's 441 that runs through the middle of the park. And you can see that some of these are closely located near roads or trailheads, while others are a little bit more remote. Once I collected that soil in the park, I had to extract the DNA. I then processed this DNA into what I call amplicon sequence variants. And this distinguishes sequence variation by a single nucleotide change. All these DNA sequences were then assigned taxonomy and will be grouped into either their biotrophic or saprotrophic fungal groups. On the other side of this diagram, I measured all of those important soil factors that I want to be testing, things like ammonium, nitrate, total nitrogen, total carbon, phosphorus, lead, and pH. I take all this data and I perform some statistical analyses to determine which soil factors are controlling fungal community composition. So the first thing I wanted to do was describe the fungal community that's present. And so this pie chart here shows the fungal diversity present in the spruce fir zone of the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. Each color represents a different phylum. And as you can see here, a majority of the phylum present in the kingdom fungi are represented, with Ascomycota, which contain most of the things we think of as molds, being one of the most dominant phyla. And then Basidiomycota, shown here in this dark yellow, which contains the mushroom-forming fungi, being the second most dominant. I also wanted to look at lead content, which is again being used as a proxy for deposition across my plots. Each circle here on the left represents a plot that I visited. The size of that circle indicates the amount of lead present at that plot. And so as you can see, the amount of deposition present at various soil plots varies throughout the spruce fir zone. I did the same thing for fungal diversity. When I looked at the raw richness of species, again, each circle represents a plot that I visited, and the size of that circle indicates the number of species that are present. So the larger the circle, the higher the fungal diversity. And again, we can see that fungal diversity is changing throughout the park, or throughout the spruce fir zone in the park. So next, I wanted to understand which soil factors are controlling this fungal community diversity. And I did this using a multiple linear regression analysis that looked at multiple diversity measures. The first one was raw richness, and this only considers whether an ASV is present or absent in that plot. When I performed a multiple linear regression, I determined that the most important factors controlling diversity were lead, nitrate, and carbon. And when I considered raw richness as the response, carbon was the most significant variable. So then I plotted carbon content on the x-axis and raw richness on the y, and we see this strong negative correlation between raw richness and carbon content, which means as the carbon content increases, we see a decrease in diversity when using this diversity measure. I've also included the strength and direction of each of these effects, and this is done using a Z-transform beta coefficient, but really all you want to look at is whether the sign is positive or negative. A positive sign indicates a positive influence on diversity, while a negative indicates a negative impact on diversity. And so we can see that both lead and nitrate in this case actually had a positive effect on raw richness, whereas carbon had a strong negative effect. So then I wanted to look at another diversity measure. And this one's called the exponential of Shannon's index, and it weights ASVs by their frequency without disproportionately favoring either rare or abundant taxa. And we can really think of this as the effective number of species present, because it's considering those species that are the most abundant or the most prominent members of this community. When I performed this multiple linear regression analysis, I determined that lead content, nitrate, and ammonium were the most important factors controlling fungal community diversity, or fungal diversity as a whole, with lead content being the most significant. So therefore, I plotted lead content on the X and the effective number of species on the Y, and we see a strong negative correlation between lead content and overall diversity. So this means that as lead content increases, we see a strong reduction in the effective number of species present in each plot. Again, I've also indicated the strength and direction of each of these factors, with lead content having a strong negative effect, nitrate having a positive effect, and ammonium having a negative effect. The next thing I wanted to do was determine how the soil communities differ between plots. And I did this using a distance-based redundancy analysis. And this is similar to a multiple linear regression, but I used a distance matrix as the response variable instead of a diversity measure. When I performed this analysis, I determined that carbon and lead content were the most important factors controlling soil fungal communities between plots. And so using these two factors, I produced a constrained ordination. Each dot here represents a soil plot that I visited. And what you want to look at is that dots that are close together are very similar, while those that are far apart are very dissimilar. And I've also colored each of these dots by whether they're present in a plot at low, medium, or high levels of nitrogen deposition. And again, this is based on that lead content being used as a proxy. So when we look at just plots at low levels of deposition, we see that some fungi or some fungal plots are very similar in community composition, while others are very different. However, as we increase the amount of deposition, we get this tighter grouping of these plots, but there still is some differences in these communities. But at the highest levels of nitrogen deposition, we see this really tight grouping of brown points, which indicates that the fungal communities are becoming more similar or homogeneous at the highest levels of nitrogen deposition. So in summary, nitrogen deposition, again, based on this lead content, varies across the spruce-fir zone. And this same result was observed by Weathers and her colleagues in 2006. Lead, nitrate, ammonium, and carbon are having the largest effect on fungal diversity. But this effect depends on the diversity measure being used. When we look at the effective number of species present, lead content is having a strong negative effect on overall diversity. Nitrogen deposition has large negative effects on these fungal communities and is homogenizing them. And this could have a strong effect on the functionality of fungi in the soil. For future work, I'm working on an indicator species analysis, which will tell me which species are the most prominent at low and high levels of nitrogen deposition, which could be used to indicate whether a site is receiving large amounts of deposition. And I'm also still need to determine how nitrogen deposition affects those two fungal guilds I talked about in the beginning, those biotrophs and saprotrophs, individually. This work has provided valuable baseline information on the fungal communities that are present in the spruce fir zone of the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. And it also has the potential to identify regions where fungal communities are at risk or contain rare species. And the preliminary analysis indicates that there may be some species present in my data set that have not been previously reported in North America. These soil samples will also be saved for future extracellular enzyme analysis, which will allow me to determine if the function of these communities is actually shifting under high rates of nitrogen deposition. So now I'm going to shift away from the nitrogen project and focus on just one genus of fungi that's present in the spruce-fir ecosystem. This genus is Rushula, which is highly diverse in its ectomycorrhizal, which again means that it's only found in these tight associations with plant species. I'm interested in determining how many species of Rushula are present in the spruce-fir zone, how large of a distribution these species have, and if any of these species are endemic or only found in spruce-fir habitats of the southern Appalachian Mountains. Here on the right, I have two pictures of the species that are present, Russia lepecki on the top and Russia lavesca on the bottom. I performed a phylogenetic analysis of the genus Russula and determined that there are 19 species present in the spruce-fir zone of the southern Appalachian Mountains. These species are all dispersed throughout this tree, which contains the entire genus, which indicates that they do not share a most recent common ancestor and that they are likely serving different functions in this ecosystem. There are also two species that are potentially new to science, but these will still require further investigation. Based on that preliminary phylogenetic analysis, I've determined that 8 of those species are distributed across eastern North America and in the southeastern regions of Canada, and they're all found in spruce-fir habitats. 4 of those species have intercontinental distributions in spruce-fir habitats. This means they're found in eastern North America and in spruce-fir regions of Europe, and even in spruce-fir regions of the Rocky Mountains. Those remaining species still require further investigation. So with this work, I need to continue sequencing additional gene regions to strengthen the phylogenetic support for my species. And I can do this by collecting more specimens and gathering more herbarium material. I'm also working on producing a key for Russula species identification. And I want to develop Russula as a model for understanding how nitrogen deposition affects mycorrhizal fungi. I want to understand the functional roles of these various species of Russula in the spruce-fir zone, and I want to be able to determine if we're seeing increase or decreases in diversity over time by comparing my collection to those that have been preserved in the University of Tennessee Herbarium. I would like to thank everybody for coming, and I can take any questions.
Thank you, Chance. We've got one question already. Can you distinguish effects of nitrogen deposition from high inputs of nitrogen into the soil from the decomposition of dead fir trees?
So one of the reasons that I'm using lead content as a proxy is because you can't just measure the nitrogen that's present in the soil, because there are all these complex ecological processes that do contribute nitrogen. And so we believe that lead is being moved through the atmosphere and deposited on the soil along with deposition. And so that's why I'm using lead as my proxy and not overall or total nitrogen. But I also wanted to look at how total nitrogen, ammonium, and nitrate would affect the fungal community diversity. And so I've measured those variables. And as you saw in the presentation, nitrate and ammonium actually did have effects on the fungal community. So I'm not sure exactly the amount of nitrogen that's being contributed to the soil community from the decomposition of fir trees. But the idea of using that lead as a proxy is to try to get around those issues and to try to get a better grasp on the level of deposition occurring.
And another question, I'd be interested to know whether soil lead content correlates well with annual 5-year, 10-year, 20-year nitrogen deposition. Can you use lead to get a sense of how the history of deposition affect these communities?
So you can, and that's what Weathers et al. Had actually done, is they correlated lead content that they measured at the deposition sites at lower elevations in the Smokies, and they confirmed that it would be useful as a proxy. There has been some research that's shown it's actually preserved through the soil interface, and that it can actually represent older. It can still be used to measure like those 10 and 20 year and longer time spans. And I plan on actually correlating my values with those that have been measured at the deposition sites in the park, but that data has not been made publicly available yet. And there is some debate about the length of time it takes lead to move through the soil column. And so it may not be the perfect proxy, but it has been previously used and still seems to be preserving at least nitrogen deposition at, you know, maybe the decade scale. And so it's still open to debate, but the research indicates that it is a useful proxy for even understanding long-term rates of nitrogen deposition.